In this screencast, we will analyze each of the individual blocks that are present in a generic feedback-only control loop. In order to motivate this, what we're going to do is we're going to focus on an example where we have a heat exchanger presented, where we are trying to warm a cold process fluid by the use of steam. So in this case, the controlled variable of interest here is the temperature of the fluid exiting the heat exchanger. And we are trying to control that by manipulating the flow rate of steam. So a nice way to start the development of this block diagram is to actually start at the end, which is the fact that the variable that we are interested in here is the temperature of the exiting fluid. So that's the variable that we are going to want out of our feedback control loop because that is our controlled variable. But what we now want to do is follow the process by which the controls work. So if we look at our diagram, we start here at the warmer fluid. We see the fact that the first thing that the temperature will see is the temperature sensor. So we'll draw the block diagram as such. And this is the block for the sensor and the transmitter block. I'll talk in more detail about this in just a minute. So what is coming into this block would be, again, the actual fluid temperature. But what the sensor transmitter is going to do is it's going to do two things. The sensor, the first part, is going to sense the temperatures. Therefore, let's assume that this fluid was 50 degrees Celsius. The sensor is going to say, okay, this is going to do the measurement that says this is 50 degrees Celsius. However, we're not done yet because the controller does not read in temperature units, mainly because controls could be used for flow rates, composition, pressures, etc. So it takes in a signal of some sort. What type of signal is dependent on the type of control scheme you have. So for the sake of our discussion here, we're going to say an electrical signal, which can be represented as milliamps. Additionally, this signal can also be represented as percent transmitter output. So a point to note here is the fact that in order for a controller to operate, a controller takes in not the value of the actual temperature. What it's interested in is the difference between the actual temperature and the desired temperature. By convention, the set point, aka the desired temperature, is the positive value, and then you take away the value of the actual temperature, the measured temperature. But an important point here is our subtraction has to be like versus like. So therefore, what has to come in here is a signal, either in milliamps or percent transmitter output. However, what comes in here is the actual steady state temperature. So therefore, we need a relationship to relate the actual desired set point temperature and the appropriate signal that goes to the controller. So this is abbreviated as KM. I'll explain more about the actual blocks again in just a minute or two. So what then happens is we go from this signal, this is now, this difference represents in milliamps or percent transmitter output, the error between the set point and the actual value. If we follow our diagram here, the value of the sensor through this dashed line gets sent to our controller, which is represented as GC. So GC will take in that error in percent transmitter output and will output a signal, usually in percent controller output, basically saying this is how active the controller should be. If we then follow the signal there, the controller then sends its signal to the valve, which is represented by GV. What will come out of the valve transfer function in this case will be the flow rate of steam. But in all situations, what will typically come out of the valve transfer function is the value of the manipulated variable, which in almost all cases is the flow rate. So therefore, this will be in some flow rate unit. So what then happens is, the last part of this connection, by changing the flow rate of steam, it is going to cause my fluid to warm. So I need a relationship between those two. That would represent the process, in other words, the heat exchanger. So this process block here would represent the energy balance on the heat exchanger, which relates how much a change in the steam flow rate will affect the temperature of the outlet process fluid. And it'll also give an idea of not only the gain, so for example, a change in 1 ccm of steam causes a 2 degrees Celsius change in the fluid temperature, but also some time dynamics, some understanding of how it will get there. Will it happen instantaneously, or will it happen over some set period of time? So that's the information we can get from the process transfer function. A note here about why this is a generic feedback-only control loop is the fact that in this analysis, we're assuming that there is just one transfer function that relates the two variables. In some cases, this may not be the case, so the process block area may be a bit more convoluted. Additionally, this block diagram does not take into account the potential of disturbances, which we'll deal with in other screencasts. So now that we've discussed this, what we're now going to do is discuss each of the blocks present in our block diagram analysis. So we'll start by looking at GM. So GM represents the transfer function for the sensor transmitter. Because of the fact that sensors generally act very quickly, this is oftentimes a zeroth order transfer function. In other words, it is just a gain, represented here as Km. Occasionally, the sensor will have first order time dynamics, which would be of the form Km over tau ms plus 1. So you may be looking at this Km and saying, well, we've already defined a variable Km in our block diagram. So we have the Km here and the Km present in this block diagram here. This is not an accident. These Kms will always be the same. To figure out why, let's think about a hypothetical here where the outlet fluid temperature is the set point. So therefore, in a case where the outlet fluid temperature is equal to the set point, that would mean that our error would be zero. In order for error to be zero, that would have to mean that the 2 milliamp signals coming in would have to be identical. So if I'm starting with the same value coming into that block, in order to get the same value coming out of those respective blocks, the Km block and the Gm block, it would have to mean the fact that the gains of the two would have to be identical. So therefore, the gain for the sensor transmitter transfer function must be exactly equivalent to the one that is handling the set point temperature. And again, this doesn't matter what type of variable it is. The next transfer function here that we see is Gc. That is the controller transfer function, and its transfer function is dependent on what type of controller you have, whether it be PPI, PID, PD, etc. Virtually all controllers must have a gain. An additional note here is the fact that Kc being greater than zero or Kc being less than zero does have some significance. So when Kc is greater than zero, it is known as a reverse acting controller. When Kc is less than zero, that is known as a direct acting controller. You can get some more information about reverse versus direct acting controllers using other screencasts. We'll move along to the next block, which is Gv, that is the valve transfer function. Valve transfer functions are typically similar to sensors, zeroth or first order transfer functions. So here we would have either Kv or Kv over tau Vs plus 1. And again, the determination about whether or not it would be necessary to include these time constants for both the sensor, the valve, and the process, which I'll describe later, is how quickly it takes for changes to be made. In most situations, the sensor transmitter dynamics can be neglected because they are much faster than the valve and or the process. In some cases, the valve can be ignored, usually in cases where the dynamics are much faster than the process transfer function. The gains of the valve transfer function are explicitly based on the fail-safe status of the valve. So here, when Kv is greater than zero, this will be what's known as a fail-closed valve. In other words, when the power goes out, the valve will be fully closed as a safety criterion. And Kv is less than zero will represent the opposite, a fail-open valve. Finally, Gp, the last transfer function block, represents the process. For an example as simple as the one we have here, where there's only one process transfer block, this will represent usually one material or energy balance. However, more complicated systems may have more material and or energy balances. And the transfer function here will be dictated by the balances. So depending on if there are things in series or whatnot, for the majority of the time, these transfer functions, particularly for a generic system, will be either first order or a first order plus dead time. But this is dictated by the balances. Process gain KP is dictated by the specific process. So in some cases, the gain will be positive, so an increase in the manipulated variable will cause an increase in the controlled variable, very similar to the example we have here, where if I increase the steam flow rate, I am going to increase the temperature of the process fluid. However, if this were cooling water instead of steam, an increase in cooling water would cause a decrease in the temperature of the other process stream, which would cause a negative gain. So in this screencast, we went through the generic block diagram for a feedback control loop and went into some detail regarding what these blocks contain.